Good morning. Thanks for joining us. I know that we have a group of women who are not here this morning. They're all at the ladies' retreat, hopefully having a good time. And I know that we have people who are traveling the world to see the eclipse. So maybe we'll have a smaller group this morning, but it's good to see you all here. And for those who are joining us online, I'm glad you could join us. I know on Sunday mornings, sometimes it's difficult. You know, you go through the whole race to get here on time. You all were here on time. That's great. Probably had a race to get here on time. I know for us, just getting ready for the service, it's you know, puts you on edge a little bit, and then it's hard to transition to that time of worship. So why don't we just pause for a moment, take a few seconds to kind of take a breath, slow down, and reflect on why we are here, why we do get up on Sunday mornings to come together to worship our God together. So let's just take a moment to prepare ourselves. I'm going to open us with a prayer from St. Augustine. It says, Almighty God, enter our hearts and so fill us with your love that forsaking all evil desires, we may embrace you, our only good. Show unto us, for your mercy's sake, O Lord our God, what you are unto us. Say unto our souls, I am your salvation. So speak that we may hear. Our hearts are before you. Open our ears. Let us hasten after your voice and take hold of you. Amen. Let's stand and sing together. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. Let's sing it again. You are here. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are way maker, miracle work, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle work, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. Oh, you are here, mending every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are.
That is who you are. That is who you are. I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working.
Even when I don't feel it, you're working.
You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle work, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle work, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
Excuse me. So I came across a video recently on YouTube, just sort of randomly, that I found interesting. It was by a guy who wanted to make a scale model of the solar system, like a really to scale model. Because a lot of times when we see pictures of it, and you know, you've got the sun and like all these planets in a row, or like a kid's science project, with all the planets going around the sun, and they're all kind of compact together. But he wanted to make a real scale solar system model, and to do that, he had to drive out to the desert because in the scale model, in his model, the Earth was just the size of a marble, but in order to get the full solar system in there, he needed 7 miles of desert just to kind of get it all in there, which is incredible. here's a few more facts about space, just for fun. Excuse me. So the Earth is tiny compared to our sun. You could fit 1.3 million of our Earths inside the sun, which is incredible. And our sun is not particularly big. If you compare our sun to the biggest suns, you could fit 5 billion suns of our suns in the biggest suns. All right? And our solar system is one of many in the Milky Way. The Milky Way, our galaxy, has hundreds of billions of other solar systems in it. So that's hundreds of billions of stars, potentially trillions of planets, right? And our galaxy is so big, if you were to hop into a spaceship and try to fly from us to the middle of the galaxy on modern spacecraft, it would take you 450 million years to get there. And light, which travels at 186,000 miles per second, takes 100,000 years to get across our one galaxy. And you know how many galaxies there are? There's like 100 billion. Billion. And that's just based on current telescope technology. As our technology gets better, there are probably even more out there, right? The numbers, it gets to the point where it doesn't even make sense. But there are more stars in our universe than there are grains of sand on the Earth. And one last thing. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the Earth.
O Lord, our Lord, your majestic name fills the earth. Your glory is higher than the heavens. When I look at the night sky and see the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you set in place, what are mere mortals that you would think about them, human beings that you should care for them? Yet you made them only a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor. You gave them charge of everything you made, putting all things under their authority, the flocks and the herds and all the wild animals, the birds in the sky, the fish in the sea, and everything that swims the ocean currents. O Lord, our Lord, your majestic name fills the earth.
Let's sing together.
I see the work of your hands, galaxies spinning, a heavenly dance. dance, oh God, all that you are, so overwhelming. I hear the sound of your voice, all at once it's a gentle and thundering noise, oh God, all that you are, so overwhelming. I delight myself in you, captivated by your beauty. I'm overwhelmed by you. God, I run into your arms, unashamed because of mercy. I'm overwhelmed by you. I know the power of your cross, forgiven and free, forever you'll be my God. All that you've done is so overwhelming. I delight myself in you, in the glory of your presence.
Have a seat.
Feels very high up here. I'm going to move this on down. Well, good morning. Welcome to Grace. My name is Adam Britton. And one of the elders here at Grace, and for those of you who've been here for a while, you know that for Communion Sunday, we do something a little bit different. We will typically have a meditation given by one of the elders and then hear from somebody who's either in the congregation or one of the ministries that we support. So we are glad that you're here, whether it's virtual or in person. And just a quick disclaimer, so communion's open to anybody who believes in Jesus. And children, with your parents' permission, you are welcome to partake in the elements as well. Last time we talked about communion that I was up here, I talked specifically about how confession restores peace and how when we bring our confessions to God, that's a restorative practice for us. And today we're going to talk about something a little different. We're going to talk about the table, and I'll tell you what led me to this. Okay, not getting the clicker, Matt, so you'll be my clicker. So I have a million hobbies. You can ask my kids, you can ask my wife. If there's something I can learn how to do, I'm like, ooh, this looks like fun. I'm going to learn how to do this. So I do grow bonsai trees. I do puzzles. I have gardens. I play guitar, record music, do lots and lots and lots of different things. So recently, and we can go to the next slide, I've got a new hobby that I've discovered, some woodworking. And it kind of started out because of yet another hobby. I get together every other week or so with a group of guys, and we do some board games. And there's actually a thing where they make dice trays where you can roll your dice into them. It's a real thing. They make dice trays that you can roll dice into. But I was like, oh, those would be kind of handy when you have five or six different people sitting around and you don't get dice everywhere. So, but they're like 50, 100 bucks for a wooden one. And I was like, I think I could make that. And so a table saw, some jigs, I'm looking at planers now, it's bad. But I'm enjoying woodworking. But the thing about it is, I feel like anytime I pick up a new hobby, you look at things a little bit differently. And so aside from walking around the house or other places and being like, that's a really nice dovetail that you have there, I love that. Or what a nice miter joint, like Tim, those miters are perfect. Other things is I was thinking about communion when I was preparing for it. I was like, why is communion at a table? It's not a sermon. It's not a lecture. He's eating with people. Why did he choose that? So when we're looking at it, is there any significance to this? And I wanted to look in the past, in the present, in the future, looking at the Bible, looking at communion. When we look at feasts, when we look at tables, when we look at banquets, what's the role in the Bible and what's its application for us here in communion? And when you think about it, the table is a place of gathering. It's a place of laughter, of sharing. There was a teacher who I knew, and one of the first days that he had class, he would always give a survey. He was a high school teacher. And the survey was, you know, how often do you have dinner with your family? Is it regularly, sometimes, rarely, or never? And he said the reason that he put that question on there was to get a barometer and say, like, okay, these kids have grown-ups checking in on them multiple times a week. These ones don't ever have dinner, and these are ones that I'm going to check in with on a regular basis. Because as many of us know, that time when you sit down with others is a relational, is a communal, is a bonding time. So when we think about that in the Bible, there's a number of different texts. Two of them I could go on for a while, but two that we probably have all heard. Song of Solomon in chapter 2, he says, he brought me to the banqueting table and his banner over me is love. In Psalm 23, I'm going to read a little bit longer portion of this, but he says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul, and he leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies, and you anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So we can see here the meals in the house. It's a place of safety and a place of comfort that God's referring to. And then we come to the Last Supper. And I am going to read the entire portion that we usually do before communion right now. In Luke 22, he says, then came the day of unleavened bread on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John saying, go and make preparations for us to eat the Passover. Well, where do you want us to prepare for it? They asked. He replied, as you enter the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him to the house that he enters and say to the owner of the house, the teacher asks, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He'll show you a large room upstairs, all furnished, and make preparations there. They left and found things just as Jesus had told them. So they prepared the Passover. And when the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table. And he said to them, I've eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God. And we'll finish the passage before we take the elements. But as we're reading these passages about the elements, or sorry, the table and banquets and feasts in the past, it's not really about a table at all. It's about relationships. Jesus is choosing to be in physical proximity and as well as in a place of emotional and spiritual relationship. And this is more just a symbol of him demonstrating the closeness of the relationship with the apostles. And fast forward to the present, every time we participate in communion, Jesus is actively pursuing sinners. God's choosing to spend time with us. He wants us to remember him. It's not just a thing of the past. And Jesus was pretty famous for eating with the wrong people, with tax collectors. You think of Zacchaeus, there's Pharisees. There's all these people that others would frown upon. In Matthew, it says, while Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? On hearing this, Jesus said, it's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I've not come to call the righteous, but sinners. And historically in the Bible, when someone was unclean, if they were around somebody else, even someone who was clean, that other person would be unclean. But Jesus kind of flips the table, pardon the pun. But when Jesus goes around people, he doesn't become unclean. He's the one who cleanses us. So the communion table, it was a place for Jesus to be together with his disciples. And it's now a place where we can be together with Jesus, and we can be together with other believers in Christ right now. And it's something that I was thinking, aren't we grateful that Jesus is still actively pursuing sinners? It's something I know I'm grateful for, because his mercies are new every day, and it's as true now as it was 2,000 years ago. So students, you go to school, you got a table that might look like this. Ours have black seats where I work. And grown-ups, you know, you might have a workplace where you sit. And you can think, the table, sometimes when you go somewhere new, can be a place of anxiety or it can be a place of comfort. I remember when I moved up to Canada, and the first day I went to the high school, I was in 10th grade, and I didn't know anybody, didn't know the routines, and having someone be like, hey, Adam, come sit over here. It's a very comforting thing. So is there a place where you're called to be that city on the hill, to be the light to other people? At your school, is there somebody that Jesus is inviting you to say, like, maybe that person needs somewhere to sit? At work, are there colleagues who we're with who Jesus is calling us to be in relationship with? All right, so we've looked at the past in the Bible. We've looked at the present, how Jesus is actively communing with us. There's ways that we can challenge ourselves to do the same. And then we look to the future. And when I was looking at banquets and feasts and tables, it just keeps pointing you to Revelation. Then I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters and like the sound of mighty peals of thunder, crying out, Hallelujah, for the Lord our God, the Almighty reigns. Let us rejoice and exult and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. It was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure. For the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. And the angel said to me, write this, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true words of God. And here, John is really, John the author of Revelation, he's writing of a future wedding celebration. And God's invited a multitude to his wedding day, and it's a glorious day. And the cool thing is, if you're a believer in Jesus, you're invited. There's a banquet coming, not where we're going to be celebrating the sacrifice that Jesus made, but where we'll actually be able to be there with other believers, with Jesus in the future. So when you're facing difficult times, difficult days, difficult weeks, difficult people, remember, Jesus invited you and wants you with him to be there. So the table, it's really a sign, it's a representation. God loves you. He wants to commune with you right now, and he has a place for you in the future. Let's take time now before we have the ushers come up just to lay down your burdens, to give thanks for the invitation that we have to be here today and in the future. Or are there things that we need to do? Because confession restores peace. So are there things that we need to do to bring before God before that? So let's take a few minutes in quiet and join our hearts together with God. Lord, as we were singing, the greatness of what you've made is almost unfathomable. It's overwhelming. And to think that in the midst of billions of stars and solar systems, that you care about us, not just as a people, but individuals. And you care enough about us that you paid a price that we couldn't pay. Lord, we're grateful for that sacrifice that you made. We come before you with thanks for it. We come before you with confessions that we're not perfect. And we know each of us has things on our hearts, things that we've done that you have called us not to do. So Lord, forgive us of these things. Lord, we also ask that today as we take communion that we would remember you. We ask for your presence to be here in Grace Community Church for those who are celebrating virtually at home, that they would know the presence of your Spirit. Lord, may our sacrifice this morning in our worship, in our songs, in our prayers be a pleasant aroma to you. We ask all these things in your name. At this point, I'm going to call the ushers forward to prepare for the passing of the bread. And Eric, would you mind praying?
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are just so thankful to be gathered together, to be able to share a common bond in relationship with you, in relationship with each other. And we thank you for the death of your Son, which makes that possible. We thank you that he allowed his body to be broken for us who were broken by sin. God, I pray that the costly sacrifice that you have made on our behalf, Father, would be in the forefront of our minds as we seek to live for you and live to bring glory to you. And be glorified in our time here this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. Praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord our God.
After communing with his disciples, Jesus took the bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Our Heavenly Father, Lord, as Robin was saying earlier, you are so incredibly large that when we think about it and try to imagine it, it becomes almost silly to think about something that's just unimaginable. The Bible tells us that you created the heavens and the earth, you held the Pleiades in your hand, and yet, thousands of years later, you sent your son to sacrifice himself for us. And you did that so that we would have a future and a hope, and a place has been prepared for us in heaven. And Lord, we think about that this morning and imagine the sacrifice. And Lord, we just ask that you would help us to live our lives in a way that is worshipful and is worthy of that sacrifice. We love you, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
His body bound and drenched in tears. They laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Thank you.
Lord, as we drink from the communion cup, we remember that you're the giver of life. You are forgiveness. You bring deep peace to our souls, and your love flows within us. We see your sacrifice poured out for us, and we notice the depth of your goodness, the pain you suffered for us, and we dwell upon the intricacy of human life, the price you paid to set humanity free. Yet as the tombstone rolled away to unleash the risen Lord, your light shines in our hearts now, extinguishing all darkness to release heaven's blessings upon us. We move from the table with the apostles to the present with Jesus' Spirit here, to the future where we might be inspired to invite others into your kingdom. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me."
Let's all stand as we finish this song.
The third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, triple death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. Praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh Lord our God. He shall return in robes of blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints. My hands transfixed on Jesus' wings. We'll praise the name of the Lord.
Dismiss the kids at this point. And I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward for our offering. I'd like it if we could all keep standing. Can we pass plates and stand at the same time? It'd be great. If we can. If you can't, that's fine. But if you can stand, that's great. Let's pray for our offering. God, we want to worship you with our words, we want to worship you in our hearts, and we want to worship you through giving back just a portion of what you have blessed us with. We thank you for all of your good gifts, from the monetary and the physical to also just the death and resurrection of your Son that you did for us. Pray that you just take this offering, that you will bless it, that we'll use it for your kingdom and your glory. In your name, amen.
something says I am guilty, I'll point to the price you paid. When something says I'm not worthy, I'll point to that empty grave. Just like Lazarus, oh, you brought me back to life. How can I begin to thank you for all that you've done for me? Fully praise you, it will take all eternity, just like Lazarus. Oh, you brought me back to life. And no longer I who live, but Christ in me, for I've been born again. My heart is free, the hope of heaven before me, the
seat. As Adam mentioned during his communion meditation this morning, being this is a communion Sunday, and here at Grace on communion Sundays, we do things a little bit differently during our worship service. We take a pause from our normal teaching time, and we like to focus our time to not only reflect on the sacrifice that was made for us, but then also to hear a little bit about what God is doing in and through our community. And sometimes we get to hear from somebody within our church to talk about what God is doing in their lives. And sometimes we get to hear from ministries and other programs that we get to partner with. And we have a special guest here with us this morning. I'm going to ask Christine Kratz from our community outreach team to come on up here and introduce our guest who will be sharing with us this morning.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Christine Kratz from the Community Outreach Committee. As you know, as Eric said, on Communion Sunday, we remember what Jesus did for us, and we listen to testimonies of how God is working in the world around us. Today, I would like to welcome Bridget DePew from North Care Women's Clinic, one of our ministry partners. She tells us how North Care is working in the lives of pregnant women and sharing God's love.
Thank you so much, Christine. And thank you so much, Grace Community Church, for having me this morning. My name is Bridget DePew, and I am a client advocate at North Care Women's Clinic. So, located in Lansdale, North Care offers free medical services and support to women to show that they are not alone, that they are capable, and that abortion is not their only option. At North Care, we are reaching women and men at their moment of making a decision. So girls who are coming through our doors are hurting and often in a crisis situation where they feel that abortion is their only option. We provide her free of charge medical services from our excellent medical team that allow her to make an informed decision and to get a full picture of her health situation. We perform pregnancy testing, ultrasound to confirm viability and age of the pregnancy, and STD testing. Each of our clients also gets a client advocate who journeys alongside them each step of the way and is there to listen to them and offer a safe space to explore what each option would look like for her. They help her look at her biggest obstacles and consider alternatives. And our client advocates can offer her material resources and community referrals as well. So even with the legal changes 2 years ago, the mission and services of the clinic have remained the same. At North Care Women's Clinic, we have seen the political change translate into women being in even more of a hurry than ever to get an abortion, as they feel they don't know when that option will be taken away. In 2023, we expanded our services and saw a substantial increase in clients. We had about 1,000 visits and performed roughly 600 pregnancy tests. Sorry. We believe that it is God's desire for both men, for both the woman and the child to flourish during and after an unplanned pregnancy. God could have chosen to bring life into the world any way that he wanted, but he chose pregnancy where the woman and the baby are intertwined. You cannot help one and bypass the other. God is equally for both, and at the clinic we seek to fight for both. We believe, and our 39 years of serving women confirm time and time again, that no woman wants to have an abortion, but many women feel as if it is their only option. The main reason that women list for having an abortion is lack of resources and lack of support. We believe that the solution is not in condemning abortion, but meeting her needs so that carrying to term can be a realistic choice for her. A study found that 86% of women will choose to have their babies if just one person, will support her. North Care exists to be a place where women can find that one person. A young woman came to us on a Monday with an abortion scheduled for that Friday. When she got her ultrasound, she discovered that she was having twins. She didn't want to take any ultrasound pictures and still felt like abortion was what she needed to do. During her medical discharge, her nurse kindly asked her one more time if she would like to take a picture, and this time she took one. On Thursday that week, we heard the voice of our nurse running around the building telling everyone she's carrying. She's going to carry the twins. How did this happen? How did this girl with an abortion scheduled just a few days later, who left our clinic still seemingly set on abortion, change her mind? Well, she told the nurse that she had decided to show her mom the ultrasound picture. And do you know what her mom said when she told her that she was pregnant with twins? She said, "We can do this. We can do this." It only took one person, in that case her mom, to support her in carrying those babies. That one person makes all the difference. If she had never come to North Care, she may have never known she was having twins, would have never received that picture, and like many women, would have gone through an abortion without ever telling anyone in her life that she was pregnant, carrying that weight solely on her own shoulders. We are here for women to take a pause and to take time to get all the information and to explore what life would look like if she chose an option other than abortion. So here's another short story that really illustrates this statistic well. We had a client whose boyfriend's mother came in with her. Her boyfriend wanted her to abort, and his mother did not want him stuck with a baby. So everyone around this girl wanted her to have an abortion. During her ultrasound, they saw a 13-week-old baby moving around on the screen. At 13 weeks, this baby had vocal cords, teeth, and even fingerprints. The mother of the boyfriend looked at the screen, sighed disapprovingly, and asked how soon the girl could get an abortion. Her advocate listened compassionately and explained to her all the help available to her. She said she wanted to keep the baby. All she needed was one person to support her, and in this case, it was her client advocate, one person to believe in her and tell her that she could do it. Again, we exist to be that place, to be a support to women when no one else will. When everyone else is telling them they are throwing their lives away and that they're stupid for having this baby when they have other options, we are here to offer them hope. Abortion is not just an issue that is outside the church. Unfortunately, it is in the church as well. And sadly, 4 out of 10 women who have abortions go to church at least once a month, and only 7% talk to someone in the church about it. The church should be the first place people turn when facing a crisis like an unplanned pregnancy. It is heartbreaking when women in our churches are making an abortion decision without talking to anyone. We know that is not Christ's heart, and we know that it is not your heart either. At North Care, we have taken a two-point approach to partner with the church to change this. So one, we offer a free one-hour church training called Compassionately Talking About Abortion, where we offer some of our expertise of over 39 years of serving women in our local community facing an unplanned pregnancy and considering abortion. The training looks into how Jesus responded to those in sexual sin and why women have abortions and how we as a church can compassionately talk about the topic of abortion and be a safe place for women. We also offer Embraced by Grace, a confidential abortion healing group. It is an 8-week Bible study where we extend Christ's forgiveness to women who feel stuck in the shame of the secret of a past abortion. So I'll wrap up with the last story that's near and dear to my heart. A client came in very much on the fence as to whether she wanted to continue her pregnancy or not. She was in a long-term relationship, but the man had a son with an ex-girlfriend who was very demanding of his time, who was very demanding of his time, and there was a lot of familial drama. This client of mine had come in a few times for her initial pregnancy tests and a couple ultrasounds. In that time, she and I developed a great rapport with each other. She told me that part of her felt that she could have this baby and that her boyfriend would be there for her. But the other part was worried he would be too overwhelmed with the things going on in his life and would leave her hanging alone with the responsibility. My client, however, was strong and had a good job, and I knew she was more than capable of caring for this child on her own should it come to that, and I encouraged her in that. After much deliberation, my client decided to have the baby, and we assured her she'd have our support and that we'd make available to her any resources that she may need. Now, whenever a woman shares with me that she's decided to have her baby, I'm excited, but I've been doing this job long enough to know that anything can still happen. So when it came time for me to make my after due date follow-up that we do for all of our clients who tell us they're carrying or even if they're undecided, I contacted my client. I asked her the outcome of her pregnancy and waited for her response with bated breath. She told me she had had her baby, and my heart rejoiced. She did confess that a couple days after having the baby, due to issues with her boyfriend, she questioned her choice. But she shared that she ultimately knew she did the right thing and said that her baby girl was worth it. We'd like to offer our new moms time to come in for baby supplies. It's an opportunity to see them and their new baby, catch up with them, and offer them much-needed diapers and other baby materials, and just catch up on how things are going in their life. My client and I had a great time catching up, and before she got ready to leave, she picked up her daughter and turned her to me and said, "Say thank you to the woman who encouraged me to have you." And I, of course, teared up happy tears. But it was not just me, though, who encouraged her to have that baby. It was the kindness of the receptionist who met her at the front desk. It was the nurse who listened and without judgment explained to her her options. It was the ultrasonographer who took the time to show her her baby and explain to her what she was seeing. And it was people like you whose support makes all the difference and makes all of it possible. I'd like to speak just a moment to any young men in the crowd. Sadly, there is a false narrative out there in society that men have no voice when it comes to the decision of whether or not their baby lives or dies. I have seen far too many times boyfriends come into the counseling room with their girlfriends, and when I ask them their thoughts on the matter of carrying or aborting, many of them say, "Oh, it's not up to me. It's her body, her choice. I don't want her feeling like I'm forcing her into doing anything, so I'll just leave it up to her." Part of the time, that's a cop-out response. The other part of the time, men genuinely believe they have no say. Well, I'm here to tell you that I've asked the girlfriends then later, when I have them alone privately, if when you told your boyfriend you're pregnant, you're scared, you don't know what to do, if he said, "Babe, we've got this. I've got you, I've got our baby. I don't care what I have to do. I'll get a second job. I'll get a job. But I'm not leaving you to deal with this all on your own." I would ask them, would that sway your decision? Even if you were still scared, would it give you pause and make you think more carefully about the option of having your baby? More times than not, the girlfriend has said yes. So men, I am asking you to be men. Don't believe the lie out there that says that we don't need you and that your opinion doesn't matter. We do need you, and your opinion absolutely does matter. When a woman is scared and faced with an unplanned pregnancy, the last thing women are thinking about is toxic masculinity. There's no time for feminist talking points. They want you to be masculine, and they want you to fight for your child. So we offer healing, abortion healing support groups. One is currently underway, but if anyone is interested in our next group, you may call our office and speak to Sharon Comley for when the next group will be meeting and ask for additional info. If you had an abortion in your past, it's okay. God loves you. The church loves you. Neither want you bearing that burden alone. So please reach out and seek help and find freedom. Thank you for partnering with us to keep us open and free to all the women in our community. And again, thank you so much for allowing me to speak with you today. It was definitely my pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing. We're going to close out with a couple last songs. Why don't we stand and sing together? Go ahead.
John 15:9-12 says, and this is Jesus' words, "I have loved you even as the Father has loved me. Remain in my love. When you obey my commandments, you remain in my love, just as I obey my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have told you these things so that you will be filled with my joy. Yes, your joy will overflow. This is my commandment. Love each other in the same way as I have loved you."
So those verses that Lily read use the word remain several times. In older translations of the Bible, we often use the word abide, to abide in his love. So this next song is just sort of a prayer that God will help us to abide, to remain in his love, and to encourage us to love him and one another.
Ah. to my thighs. I am yours forever, you're mine. Draw me close and teach me to apply.
In Romans 8, Paul writes, against its will, all creation was subjected to God's curse. But with eager hope, the creation looks forward to the day when it will join God's children in glorious freedom from death and decay. For we know that all creation has been groaning, as in the pains of childbirth, right up to the present time. And we believers also groan, even though we have the Holy Spirit within us, as a foretaste of future glory. For we long for our bodies to be released from sin and suffering. We too wait with eager hope for the day when God will give us our full rights as his adopted children, including the new bodies he has promised us. We were given this hope when we were saved. And the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. For example, we don't know what God wants us to pray for, but the Holy Spirit prays for us with groanings that cannot be expressed in words. And the Father, who knows all hearts, knows what the Spirit is saying. For the Spirit pleads for us believers in harmony with God's own will. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them.
How can I say it is well when my voice can barely speak? How can I sing you a song in the midst of suffering? Jesus, will you meet me here? Let your peace wash over me. I need you now more than ever. Teach my soul to sing. My God is still in control. And still he reigns on his throne. Though mountains may tremble and sea billows roll, I'll sing it is well with my soul. My God is still in control. You have not left me alone, though the world has let me down. All of my sorrow and pain, I will trade it for a crown. Thank you for staying with me when the night was closing in. Whatever my life, you are still God, I will sing again. My God is still in control, and still he reigns on his throne. They tremble and see the lows. I'll sing it as well in my soul. My God is still in control. It is well with my soul. It is well with my soul.
You can have a seat. I want to thank you all for being with us this morning and worshiping with us this morning. Bridget, thank you for being with us and sharing with us from North Care. Our partnership with North Care has been such a blessing to us, and we're so thankful to be able to be involved in it. And I want to thank all of you for being here with us and worshiping here with us this morning. And if you're new to Grace or you're relatively new to Grace, we would love the opportunity to get to know you a little bit more, to say thank you for being here with us this morning. In your bulletin this morning, there is a QR code that you can scan with your phone, and that'll just give you the opportunity to let us know a little bit more about you. Let us know ways we can be praying for you. If you have specific questions about who we are as a church, we'd love to answer those questions and get to know you a little bit more. So if you can go ahead and scan that and fill that out, we would be very thankful. Or you can fill out one of the slips of paper on the welcome wall on your way out in the lobby. As we wrap up, I want to tell you a little bit about just some things that are going on in the life of our church. We exist at Grace here to live lives of worship together, and we desire to do that in a variety of ways. We desire to be worshiping in truth and growing in our understanding of God's word and our ability to apply that to our lives. This is our last week of a break from Discovery Class. Next week, we will be starting up Discovery Classes again. And in our adult class, we'll be starting a study in the book of James, led by Jim Veith and Andrew Rodriguez. Make sure you join us for that. Also, we desire to be worshiping in the world, and we desire to be making the goodness of God known to people outside of our church. Obviously, we heard a lot about ways we can do that here this morning from North Care. We also just wrapped up a series just before Easter, our Global Missions series, where we had the opportunity to hear from all of the missionaries and mission organizations that we support that are working all around the world making the goodness of God known and making the gospel known. If you have heard that over the last several weeks, and maybe that's kind of stirred something in you, a desire to maybe be involved in that kind of work, we are looking for a couple more people that might want to be involved as part of the global outreach team, affectionately called the GO team, that Stan has dubbed it, the global outreach team. So if that's something that, as you've heard from our missionaries over these past several weeks, and you thought, hey, I'd love to just be involved in helping to facilitate our connection as a church to these people and these organizations that are serving God all over the world, talk to Stan about that. You can talk to myself. You can talk to any member of the GO team. We'd love to talk about you potentially being involved as a part of that team. And we desire to be worshiping in the community. We're missing a lot of our women here this morning as they are away on the women's retreat. They'll be coming back today. So just be praying that that time has been meaningful, refreshing, uplifting, and that they get home safely today. That it's just been a time of, you know, glorifying to God and uplifting to them. So as we wrap up, would you join me in prayer? Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, sorry. We do have one other announcement that I almost forgot. Bob, come on up here. And apparently Bob almost forgot about it too. But yeah, one other announcement to come on up.
Thank you, Pastor Eric. You know, I am so pleased that God is in control, because I get out of control. But let me tell you why I'm here. Some of you have heard about Good Stuff Thrift. I just want to share a brief summary with you of what we've been able to accomplish. We're a Christian-based nonprofit organization who sells donated items to generate cash that we give directly to our 12-plus partners. And you can pick up a pamphlet. I brought some with me after you leave service today. 100% of our profits go to these charities as cash gifts. And who are we talking about when we talk about our charities? We have a middle school, a mental health organization, a free clinic, adoption services, foster care services, mothers with new babies, mothers with unwanted pregnancies, single mothers with children who want to go back to work, teen programs to keep them focused and out of trouble, a food bank, and a kids camp, and it's growing. We currently have 4 locations, and we have over 130 employees. Last year, we completed our 10th year, and we were able to generate during those 10 years over $5 million in contributions to these charities. And we're talking, these charities are all within Montgomery and Bucks County, so we're not going national, nor do we plan to. We also give thousands of dollars each year in furniture, household goods, clothing, and other items to families in need that are not part of our revenue. Our volunteer board, our CEO, generously give of their time, which helps generate more cash to be able to give to the charities. We also have been blessed to help others over the years. For example, we currently provide 3 paying jobs and 12 to 14 volunteer opportunities for people with special needs. We also have been providing opportunities for over 200 people, mostly kids. I don't think anybody's here from this list, but court-ordered community service. We're probably familiar with it. And we have benefited from thousands of hours of volunteer support from generous people like yourself. One area that we did not anticipate over the years was our ability to help those in recovery from alcohol and drug abuse. We currently have 22 employees, and 2 of those are our top leaders within the organization, who are also helping to start programs where they help others to survive the without addiction. 2 years ago, we purchased a house, which now houses 4 of our staff in an affordable, sober living environment. Monitored quite well. We also sponsor 2 12-step programs at 2 of our locations every week. So how can you help? I'm sure you were waiting for this, right? On Saturday, April 27th, we'll be having here at Grace a donation drive that we're looking to help you empty out your house of clothes, furniture, anything that you just don't want anymore. And obviously, we're not asking for anything brand new. We do have good stuff to sell, and that would be wonderful. There's a list of what we do to accept on our website, goodstuffthrift.org. And if you'd have any questions, you can contact me. My name is Bob Clark, and I'm in the church directory. So thank you very much. Have a blessed day.
Thanks, Bob. All right, would you join me in prayer as we close? Heavenly Father, we're just so thankful to be gathered together today as your people, gathered together to celebrate the relationship that we get to share with you, to remember and celebrate the death of Christ on our behalf. And we can all as continually celebrate his resurrection as we celebrated just last week, and the fulfillment and confirmation of all of the promises that that brings, Father. Father, we pray that you've been glorified in our time and our worship here this morning and our sharing of what you're doing in the world. And we pray that you'd continue to be glorified in our lives as we leave this place and desire to show people your goodness and your greatness. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a great week.